often that I speak this early in the morning. normally I would say good afternoon or good evening, but good morning, and Hawa, so much for having me here. Hawa to the Exhibition Planning Committee and the Textile Society of America for selecting me to present to you. And thank you so much for the introduction. I don't know what there is left to say. You said it all so well. I prepared a small thing last night as an introduction. It just kind of came, and I wanted to kind of elaborate just a little bit on the title that I selected for this presentation. So Threads That Do Not Break, Finding My Path as a Northwest Coast Weaver. The threads that do not break are the ones we cannot see. They're those that we carry within us. They're the ones that pass silently from generation to generation. It has been these threads that, even though at times they may be dormant, are always present. I think it requires a shift in thinking, a way of seeing ourselves and the world around us in a new way. I invite those in this room to share in that space that is created by our being here. I invite those in this room to unfold themselves as fabric, woven by our ancestors, and with the threads in our very hands, what picture we are going to weave for our descendants. There's tremendous power in the present moment and in our ability to weave a new story for those who come after us. I grew up as a child in one of the strongest Indigenous communities on the Northwest Coast, in my perspective, and yet it has only been as an adult through this journey of transformation offered to me by weaving that I've learned the things I'm so honored to be able to stand here before you and share. It's a tremendous opportunity to enact the tradition of an oral storyteller. Sometimes when I'm speaking, I feel like that's through the work and a desire to share something that's very close to my heart and has meant a lot to my transformation as a person and my new understandings as a person. To be able to stand here with that, you know, a lot of the times I'll come up and I won't have anything prepared. I'll just start talking and anyway. A lot of that is because my story is my own, and I've told it many times publicly, not always in a longer format, but in this way, it's one that I've grown familiar with. It becomes something more like a territory, the pathways of knowledge more well, and the story shifts from the linear to the global, with all parts interconnected that you can enter the story at any point and still reach all of the other points through that pathway. And yet with each new telling of the same story, a new connection is formed and the story grows. The story, as an oral story, is a living thing, growing and shifting, and always making itself new as it unfolds again each time, as though a new version of itself. I was asked to give an illustrated talk for this presentation. So from what I've said, it's a little bit out of my reach sometimes. My partner helped me a lot to put it together. So yeah, I'm doing my best to structure this into something that can still be alive in the present, but also can offer some visuals to some of the words. So I'd like to begin with a brief introduction of myself, maybe a little bit more in depth. And then at the end of it, kind of, it might overlap a couple of things, but there was also a film that traveled with the International Film Festival that my friend Darcy Hennessy Turin had put together, that kind of recapped a bit of these things as well in a really beautiful way. But I kind of want to begin with, when I introduce myself, that's usually where I start, that's where we all start to state who we are and where we come from. And although I was born in the community of Alert Bay, British Columbia, my lineage comes from Ireland through my father, who was born in Dublin, and my mother, who is Haida and Kwakwaka'wakw. And yet, even though I grew up in what I perceived to be one of the strongest communities on the coast, it's really incredible to me that I didn't really connect with much of this in a really meaningful way until later in life. I had a college professor who was teaching at Capilano University in the writing department, and I was just taking an English composition class, and he was just really interested in Indigenous politics. And he had us reading oral transcriptions of a woman who had gone to school at St. Michael's, the residential school, and look great. And I remember the feeling I had when I was reading it, and as I stepped further into exploring the history of Alert Bay and the residential schools, just this feeling of how come I don't know this, and why was I not taught this in a more direct way growing up? That I could grow up in a community and still not really understand our history. I think a lot of that's changing. But before I started moving, I spent, like was mentioned, about 15 years, five of which of those years were professional snowboarding. And when I started weaving, I was really on that path, and I was getting near cusping at the point of where it would really turn into something very fruitful if I'd kept going. And I'd also spent a lot of time commercial fishing, so probably even longer than that, since I was about 4 years old. My dad's a commercial fisherman, and I'd spent many years on the boat, and most of my adult life on the boat. 2010 was my last year commercial fishing. After some travel in my very early 20s, I went to Switzerland, Greece. I hitchhiked all over BC and hitchhiked from Germany down to the southern part of Italy to take the ferry over, and that was very, like, very much like rejecting fishing as a profession, and just feeling like it was so wrong that our all of these beautiful salmon caught on the Northwest coast and that once supported an entire population in this area were now exported globally. And that was really bothersome to me, and I was wanting to get away from it. And so I'd gone cherry picking for the summer. But it was really funny because what I encountered in that was the same kind of tensions that go on in a family business, and also that there were cherries in BC that I'd never seen that were being exported to England and Japan, similar to our fish. Wow, it's really similar. Like, maybe fishing isn't the problem. Maybe part of it is like globalization. And through the travels, I really recognized that what I shared with my dad on the boat and what I had been able to experience and see on the Northwest coast was so precious and so rare. And like the whole great, the Great Bear Rainforest that stretches from the northern tip of Vancouver Island up to Prince Rupert and probably a bit further on into Alaska, but that territory is largely untouched. And even kind of before I started awakening through the weaving to some of these like steps along the way, I guess, that changed me so drastically, there was always this undercurrent of valuing that land. I would spend every year, I would go there, kind of, it was what really brought me back was the ability to be on the land in a meaningful way. And it wasn't a huge cross-section or slice of time out of that commercial fishing experience, but I think it was incredibly important, and it has, for me, my weaving as a practice has been born out of that place of connection to, I guess, a forest or like an ecosystem that exists on the earth that, for me, when I look at it, it's looking at the identity of Mother Earth in a way that it hasn't been drastically altered by our overlaying what we want to see done with it. And it wasn't until a few years later that I really pieced together through a couple of different experiences traveling that place, I think that there's a tremendous intelligence and tremendous spirit that exists in the lands that we stand on. And I think that goes far beyond one indigenous place. I've had the opportunity to travel to a few places, some of them that I didn't think I would go to. But in those places, like one of them was Fiji, and it was amazing to spend time with traditional weavers, like weavers there and Fijian people, and realize that this place in my mind I had really perceived it as being a luxury destination for tourism and beautiful beaches, but that is a traditional territory to a huge number of people. Just as an aside. So, anyway, sorry, this is an example. I thought that was already on there, this slide. And I'll just share this videos. They're about 4 minutes long. Just as a recap and to add some visuals to some of those ideas of the snowboarding and some of the weaving.
My name is Meghann O'Brien. It's my English given name. Recently, since connecting with other parts of my identity that I was disconnected from before, I've become integrated into my Haida and Kwakwaka'wakw lineages. I grew up in the community of Alert Bay, which is like, now that I know it, it's an extremely strong cultural community with a really deep history. There's a lot of the really old ways of teaching and of being with each other that have survived through colonization. I think we, you know, inherit certain things that aren't healed when we're born, and I inherited a lot of shame. Even as like a small kid, I never really wanted to be Native, I guess. Basically, when I started weaving, it was very strong, and I felt the culture for the first time in a way that I'd never experienced, like I never had connected with it before. During that time, I was working closely with the original fiber we used on the coast, which was mountain goat wool. And while I was working with it, I was just feeling like I'd spent so much of my time in its environment. There was one time when I was spinning wool, but it was so like rich of an experience that I was like, wow, this is like, I feel as alive as when I'm going down the mountain. I feel like I was a very successful example of colonization. Somebody that comes from somewhere, now that I know it, comes from somewhere really ancient, an ancient culture that's very strong, has like a beautiful way of being in the world, and yet I wanted nothing to do with it. And I just felt like, you know, if I ever have kids, like I would have never passed this on to them if I didn't start weaving, and it would be totally dead. When I started snowboarding and being in the mountains, I was really inspired by them and I was kind of obsessed with them. I always wanted to be there and I really loved snowboarding. Growing up and having snowboarding such a huge part of your like identity or your ego attachment, kind of attaching your self-worth to progression or to like what you can do rather than like your intrinsic value. I feel like it got too tangled up, so mountains kind of at one part of my life turned into a place more where, more of like a stage, I guess, and especially in like pursuing snowboarding as a career. In perspective now, I mean, I went through this process where I stopped snowboarding completely for about a year. I really wanted to return to them with a different perspective, more rooted and based in like what our culture says that mountains are. You know, everything has spirit, and the spirit of the mountain to be in that and to just be present in that environment is so gorgeous, a place to spend time in. And snowboarding is such a cool tool, like to be able to interact with nature in that way. We usually approach like the natural world as something that we want to take from. We always see it in terms of how is it of value to us. And sometimes I feel like the mountains, we even approach them in the same way, that they're resources that we extract from. They're not tangible resources, but we're still approaching them that we want to take something that's a benefit to us. In my way of thinking of it, like we are a part of nature and we are meant to be a part of it, we're meant to be integrated with it. So to take the mentality that we destroy it, so we need to protect it and quarantine it off somewhere else, it's like separating ourselves from it further. But I think the key more of it is like reestablishing like a healthier connection to it. And I started to think like our earth, the entire earth, is like the basis of everything that we are. But that the language of the earth is something that we've forgotten how to listen to. It doesn't stop communicating with us, but we have stopped listening. Right here, right now, like we're sitting in the middle of everything we need to live comfortably, like live luxuriously, I think. Like, I think that the way we lived was probably like really high quality of life. And for people that don't agree, sometimes they don't agree with me or think I'm too like romantic about what it was like. But if you were to put it in a dollar value for like the wood and all of the seafood that we had and like just the way that we lived, you'd need to be a millionaire.
Although I've had many teachers who've worked with me on the Northwest Coast over the years, I do strongly feel as though the weaving is also a part of my lineage and my genetics. So into the deep local. I was a good candidate for this talk because that's what my journey has been, I think. Spending a lot of time in the world of snowboarding, which looking at it now in contrast to Indigenous weaving and my pathway through that, snowboarding is set, I consider it a global culture, like spending time in Switzerland and I've been to Japan, but I hear it echoed from other snowboarders that as such a recent sport or lifestyle, it's very, snowboard is a very similar mentality anywhere you go in the world. So contrasting that with the draw that I felt and the sense of belonging that I felt going into the community of Alert Bay and kind of having mentors along the way who nourished that kind of initial spark. Bo Dick was one of the earliest people I was attracted to learning from, and he's the one who taught me, or maybe not taught me, but he taught me a lot of things, but he introduced me. I remember I walked into his home and he was like, oh, okay, you want to learn to weave? My sister, my daughter's coming here for her potlatch. She'll teach you to weave. And she has some funny stories about that because she was in her seclusion in the woods for one of the traditional roles to be performed in the ceremony, she was sitting by a fire and I brought her a bucket of cedar that had been soaking, and as fast as I put a log of wood on the flame and turned around, she had already taken the cedar out of the bucket and started to split it and was about this, like 2 inches already into plying some rope. And she told me this is going to be for the plaque that goes around this mortuary pole that was going to be part of the potlatch. So I spent about 2 to 3 months working with her in Alert Bay, and I learned kind of that initial desire for me was to pick berries, and I worked mostly at the start during that summer fishing, sort of jump back into the summertime. I had worked on my own a fair amount and really connected with some of what I think to be the teachings that come directly from the plant. And when you approach something in a way, I think
where you're open to learning from it with not a lot of preconceived ideas, there is like a different space that opens up in yourself. So that was kind of the origin, and that was the real pathway that opened up my interest in culture. And then once that interest was opened, the way that it was nourished by the community of Lenore is something I'm incredibly grateful for. So the people like Carrie Dick and Donna Cramner. This is the interior of the big house in Alert Bay. So within basketry, I've had three different types of weaving I've been involved with in my traditional training, I guess. The first was basketry, connecting to that feeling of being on the Northwest Coast and initially starting on my own. So trees as teachers. In a very basic way, I felt as though, because I didn't have a teacher or a book at the start, as I started, I thought, well, I'm supposed to soak this. And the one person on the boat who had taught me how to harvest the bark, he kind of closed his mouth after that. And he watched me weave my entire first basket dry, because he told me, I was like, I think I'm supposed to soak it. I can picture like the cedar colored water with the cedar in it soaking and being pliable. And he's like, oh, that's one thing I know for sure, they definitely don't soak it. I spent that whole first basket kind of like manipulating it to soften it, like we would for some other regalia or like canoe capes. But as I was doing that, I eventually started soaking it because it seemed logical. And I had begun cutting it with scissors and then holding a knife on the counter and pulling it through. And then I remember the moment when I first kind of discovered the grain of the wood and how it, the feeling that it opened up was so like, wow, this is amazing. And then examining it further and the way that it splits apart on the vertical and the depth level as it is on the surface of the tree was so tremendous. And I was really working from a place where I felt as though the connection that the cedar tree had to our people stretches back millennia. Some of the archaeological sites recently found on Calvert Island and underwater ones found on Haida Gwaii a few years back date us to 14,000 years. And to my eye, coming at it from a snowboard perspective with not a huge level of community involvement, I didn't really see cedar being used in a very big way. So I this idea of genetic memory, this sense of maybe it's animating inanimate forms with human qualities, but I felt that the cedar tree missed us and that it played such a huge role in our path as a people. And I felt as though wanting to make something like a basket for carrying berries in, that intention, I think it opened up something different for me and led to a pretty strong belief that that there is knowledge carried in the land, and the land being a foundation of our art and culture. This is a photo of that splitting apart process for one of the finer, well, all of the baskets I'll show you right now on this slide are finer baskets. The initial pieces that I worked on were larger scale, and I did about four larger scale pieces. I used a couple of them still. My first one was gifted to my grandmother. And my second one was used, I used it for berry picking for quite a long time. Yeah, there's two approaches, I guess. I was afraid by doing a keynote. Keynote with slides that I'd end up wanting to talk about every image and get sidetracked and not get through it. Just because of that part where, you know, you end up talking about one thing and then I think I have to go back just a couple to get to that basket. So I can talk a little bit about this basket for sure. This is my most recently completed piece, and it's a collaboration with my cousin Jay Simeon. Usually when I'm working on the finer baskets, they unfold over usually about 2 years, where I'll spend about 2 weeks at a time, back and forth, or maybe a month at a time, going back to the pieces. Just because they're, for one, I don't have as good of a technique, and for two, it's just nicer that way. I feel like I'm always stepping into the process of making it where it's always feeling really good, not like it's under a timeline pressure. But this piece I've actually woven, I'm very attracted to the work baskets that were used before the commercial or before the like tourism trade on the Northwest Coast, so they're very plain usually. So I'd woven this one during a time also when I was really getting interested in an artist, Canadian artist named Agnes Martin, who I guess kind of like worked with the concept of the grid a lot in her abstract expressionist paintings, and I was thinking of her a lot and just like the idea of a grid as a very weaverly construct, I think. So I'd done it entirely plain, and it was like my version of a circle grid, really. So it was perfect for the overlay of an image. My cousin Jay had been commissioned to paint it with one of our family crests from Haida Gwaii, which is sculpin. So that was that basket. I can start talking though. The next section is on Chilkat and Raven's tail weaving, and really for that start of it with the basketry, I had all of these really intentions of wanting to use it on the land, and I think it was born from a very solitary practice. After I spent that first summer with Carrie, the following spring, her mom was coming to Alert Bay to teach her Chilkat. And she didn't really give me much choice in the matter. She said, "You're learning, my mom's coming, and you're learning Raven's tail weaving. She's doing a class, and that's about it." And she didn't give me a lot of choice. So that's what I started on, and once I did start on it, I was hooked, you know. It's quite addictive, as we all know in this room. So after that, I asked Sherry if I could go learn with her in Haida Gwaii, and that led to working with her teacher, William White, with whom I spent 2 years apprenticing in the parts of BC. And I just want to express like a tremendous gratitude for the way that they took me under their wings and really shared the spiritual and cultural foundation of the work. A lot of the times now, when I look back on it, on the way that things have unfolded, the way that traditional art forms, I picture them as though there's a tree growing and that the leaves on the outside are contemporary or like are an expression of that. And in that way of a tree, the way that it's growing and expressing, it represents also the generations of us as people and the cycling of art as it's made, which kind of connects to it as a way of an education for our people, I think, before writing and all of these things, the traditional art forms as pathways into culture and ceremony. An image of me weaving at Museum of British Columbia, or Museum of Anthropology at UBC. So you can see the loom, that's no tension on the bottom. It's sometimes referred to as gravity weighted. And the value of working with William White was he's a very, very excellent teacher, and he's actually teaching a class right now in Northern BC.
to a group of Tsimshian women, which is really exciting. But this was the project I worked with him the most on, where he really, because I'd worked with Sherry and Carrie earlier, he really broke me of my old fingering, like my habits, my bad habits, and retrained me in a very specific style of manipulating your hands and the weft and the warp in a way that doesn't cause repetitive motion, like injuries in your hands. This is the first braided tail rope that I created. And it was actually, the full size image of this didn't really fit very well, but this is a detailed shot of a ceremonial dance apron. It's on display right now at the Bill Reed Gallery. And it was on this piece that I really started to question where, well, these are meant to be worn, and you know, what's going on with my own family? That was kind of the idea. And this was also woven just after that piece. I think it was one of my first pieces outside of working with a teacher. So as much as I value and respect my teachers, I remember the first time that I wove wool, and it was merino wool that's, and for a number of reasons, is not that available on the Northwest Coast. Some of the elders in the Inler Bay did hunt them when they were younger. But I want to talk a little bit just about gifts from the land and creator and consciously engaging with material and process, because from the 2 year span of when I started working with wool to being able to work with mountain goat wool, which was the original fiber on the coast, the opportunity to work with that was something was precious to me. And I was, because of the experience with cedar, very much approaching it as a teacher and wanting to learn from it directly. And there's another short clip that kind of shows the spinning process that I undertook. It has no sound, or shouldn't have any sound, but just make sure. So it kind of, as it's playing, I'll kind of just explain some of the spinning process that I worked with. George Emmons' book, The Chilkat Blanket, where he describes in a very brief detail the steps that the Tlingit weavers were using at the kind of around the turn of the century. So for me, I played at times with using a drop spindle, and I kind of went back to doing it thigh spinning, which is the way that he said it was done. So the mountain goat hide that I worked with, that you're seeing now, was hunted on Tsimshian territory just off the Skeena River near the Axtu Valley. And I'd spent about 2 years kind of praying and asking for that opportunity to work with the fiber. And it was such a tremendous gift when it came. So in Emmett's book, he talks about how the hide was wet on the skin side and then rolled up to sit for some time. And I worked with that technique, and then I washed it after. I guess with this, like this kind of stage in the process of working with it, I was feeling very much like I had romanticized what it was going to be like in a breathing way. Okay, now we're going to spend hours and hours and hours taking all these guard hairs out. Which I went OCD on and just went to town. But it was one of the times working with this fiber, though, once it was dry, once it was even just taking the guard hairs out, because it was one day when I was taking the guard hairs out that I had this feeling and sensation. I think this sensation is reflected in some of the literature and some of the teachings, especially in the Kwakwaka'wakw Nation, where through Franz Boas, so much is documented. And I really felt as though the materials, like essence or energy, was going up in my arms, and it just created this incredible feeling of warmth in my heart. And I remember in this process of spinning, the first moment when I was able to like take something that had been very, very, very loose and unstable and stretch it between my hands, that it was just this epiphany of, yarn is so incredible. And there was like something in this,
in the process of doing it, because it's so connected to the mountains, where it invited me to reassess and relook at the way that the relationship I had developed with mountains as more of a platform of human achievement to make video parks and get photos for magazines and stuff. And it really invited me to go back into those in a new way, kind of like how that video is suggesting. There's just some more images of it. And I'd like to get, just in interest of time, I really want to get to speaking a bit more about how I feel along this journey this has connected me to, because very quickly, the offers through the UMISTA Cultural Center to travel came quite quickly. And I had stopped snowboarding the year that I worked on the Raven's Tail Rope. And my intention was that I wanted to be going into relationship deeply with the land and the territory that I was from. And the first trip was like 2011, I think, and it was to Germany for the Power of Giving. And I think there's, I just want to kind of explore like the pan global and like what does it mean kind of to export culture or to commodify culture or to participate in something in an art market that's kind of what I think is how Indigenous art in particular, especially in Canada, I think it was always of interest, but during the potlatch ban, when it was lifted, and the way that our art has, the creation of the art market, which was established a lot by Bill Reid and people like Doug Cranmer for the carving, that was maybe in the 60s and 70s, it was really being established. But just to kind of explore, I guess, like what that means and the way that I was questioning it and kind of being like, this is where I need my notes, but kind of being like, the question of like after a decade of devoting myself to learning these skills, what does it mean to have these skills in the world today? What does it mean when I look at Chilkat weaving especially? These are things that were made from a society that was thriving and intact, and as a cultural expression, it's one of the highest forms, I think, of our people's expression, because it's ceremonial in nature. Virtually chiefs and matriarchs wore it, so very few people wore them, and they're rarely used. They're not everyday garments. They take up to a year to make for the historical master weavers, and more like 2 years to make now for contemporary weavers. Like what does it mean to create these pieces? Because the model has been, weave a piece of ceremonial regalia and sell it as art almost exclusively. And sometimes there's relationships between artists and collectors or artists and galleries where there's a fluidity in between those things, those two, because just the nature of valuing this kind of work, I think there's like a lot of consideration that goes into it on both sides of things. But this piece here in particular was really exploring that idea, and I made these specifically to be something for sale. I was kind of at this period about 3 years ago, like what can I weave that I won't feel obligated to keep for my family? So these were bentwood box, portions of bentwood box designs. At the Museum of Anthropology in the Haida section. It's on display. And there's these boxes that have really thick angular black form lines. And I pulled from three sides of those, the small squares in the corner of the box. And I decided to try weaving a supernatural being who no clan or crest owns them. And I didn't wear them anyway, but and then around the same time I was working on those, I started this project, which is a Chilkat dance apron. And it's a replica of a Chilkat apron. That was a robe that was cut ceremonially, and the chief who received half of that robe cut it into three pieces and re-put it back together. So that was another one that wasn't as crest-based. And then this is an example showing some of the techniques and an example of a lot of the pieces being
worn. So one of the ways that emerged kind of organically for me to answer this question of what is the place and the role of weaving today with such a globalized world and such a world where there's so much cross-cultural exchange. I've been considering it for some time and looking at these. I've always had an interest in fashion. I mean, when I was in high school and elementary school, even I was buying Vogue and Bazaar magazines all the time. So it was of interest to me, and then more recently I came across some of the making of videos for the haute couture brands like Chanel especially, and I had met during one of these journeys to France. I met a weaver in France who did commission-based work for the major fashion houses, and that kind of got me started thinking of, that's an interesting platform for weaving in textiles. So I started considering how can I bring forward our textiles in a contemporary way where the materials and the techniques and the process are all being honored, and honoring the fact that these were meant to be worn. I think there must be an avenue where there's an appropriate form. And for now, for me, that form has been kind of expanding on the idea of necklace and pendants. So I was visiting the Gucci store for my necklace and was playing with it as something like that. And this is I participated in Western Canada Fashion Week that kind of arrived organically as an opportunity. And I started sewing smaller pieces of clothing, sewing clothing so that half of it was style outfits and half was my own. And then these images are from the first Toronto Indigenous Fashion Week that was led by designer and artist Sage Paul. Incredibly powerful woman and aims to do some really big things in terms of bringing Indigenous artists in contact with some of the bigger fashion houses to see if there's a possibility of collaboration in a respectful way. This is an image of me wearing those first pieces I was showing of the mouse woman, and they're really a joy to wear. And then these are images from Western Canada Fashion Week. And I was in one of these float tanks, and I started, because I was trying to consider making medicine pouches. It's done a lot on the coast and has been for quite a while. But I wanted to kind of reimagine, like, how can you make it look more aesthetic with a pendant and a necklace? And the warp has always been fascinating to me. I was thinking, I want to have more of the warp visible, because I spend a lot of time making it nice and putting lots of cedar in it. The cedar gives it this incredible body and structure. So I had this idea of warping the loom instead of it hanging at every inch down, looped over like this, warping it in a complete circle. So that's what these ones are done, and they can be worn as necklaces or bracelets. And this is one of the other ways that I warped it on the loom. Kind of finicky to set up, but it's worthwhile. And then 7 inches of historical Charles and Michelle bracelet, which is so beautiful together. And then another style of warping it a little bit, the Santa Berry pendant. Can be worn as a choker or a longer piece tied in the back. The chaos after one of the fashion shows is kind of very much after the pieces have been thrown off models. You put them in this pile. Very alive. And then most recently, this is one of the concepts that I explore in the exhibit that's up at the Villery Gallery that I kind of stuck within this one. It's weaving as technology. That similar desire of finding place. One of the robes that I made back in 2014 was completed in 2014 and went on exhibit within hours of finishing it. And then from there, it traveled to Campbell River, which is one of the home territories I'm from, and then to
Haida Gwaii directly after, and then right from Haida Gwaii I went to Winnipeg Art Gallery, and then from Winnipeg to Santa Fe, and then from Santa Fe back to me, and then I went back to another show, and it was just like 4 years of it being gone. And I danced it at the museum opening, but I didn't, I'd never had it used ceremonially in the big house with our culture. And Jamie Isaac, the curator of WaterX, asked me, would you be willing to loan this until 2022, like after some calls? And I was like, this is crazy. Like, it's an honor to be have your work shown, but it's also like, what are you working for? And out of that, her desire to have the piece shown and my desire to have it used in the community, she was like, what do you think about 3D printing this piece, making a 3D model of it? And I was like, well, that's brilliant. You're amazing. Like, you're so incredible to think of that. And it just put together so many things in my mind. And so I reached out to Bill McLennan and Karen Duffick at Museum of Anthropology, and they suggested I get in touch with Kate Hennessy at SFU's Making Culture Lab. And that's turned into, in the last 3 months, a really, really engaging and interesting project, especially when I sit down with the designer who's making the digital models. So we did a digital animation of the piece, because 3D printing actually takes a lot longer than any of us really realize. I think my Jamie and myself, our vision of it is that, like, okay, we're just gonna like put the robe in this like thing, and it's gonna read it, and it's gonna swap it out like another version of it. There's an, it's, what's been surprising is that there's an incredible human element to the making of like 3D objects. And I'm sitting down and speaking with Conrad Fly. This is a screenshot of his computer working on the photogrammetry process. So on the very far left of the image is a selection of, they took 280 images of the robe and then stitched them all together and then make this 3D version of the piece. And I don't know how we're doing for time. I did include the film that he made. It's a 4-minute animation. If you'd like to see it, it's kind of reflecting. It's got no sound, so I can speak over it, which is good. So as we were talking and as he was showing me, I mean, I would jump out of my skin. I was so excited when he would explain to me how this, like the laser scanner also, we took information about it, how that scanner brings all of the information about an object into the digital world. And you could, once it was in there, it was like it was moving around, and there was the back of it and the front of it and everything. And there's all these like layers of building a digital image, I guess. And so what we decided on doing was kind of, at one point I felt as though this digital version of the robe was actually enacting and giving visible, like tangible form almost to something that it almost felt more real or more expressive than the original piece to me, to be able to give visuality or something to the ideas I had and the things that I was feeling while I was weaving. So when they were taking it in the laser scanner, it was, they're called cloud points or point clouds. I was like, that's so incredible because of this whole connection with the mountain goat wool and the cycles of water, and like seeing it as like this shifting of states between a gas, a liquid, and a solid, and like a steam, like ice and snow and water and rivers, all of that encoded and contained within the wool itself. And then this piece kind of going from a journey from a manifest form into form and then out of form, kind of reflecting the window moves in and out of it. So there's the point cloud pass and the wireframe pass, and this is called the natural pass, or no, the beauty pass is the one of the actual piece, and then there's a purple version of it that's called the natural pass. And I'm fascinated with that one because this one turned out really beautiful, like purple, like light purple, bright purple kind of thing that you'll see in a minute or something. But that every object, I guess, when they take it into the digital world, the natural paths, it has its own color,
and everyone is different. So that was really, it's been really interesting to learn about all aspects of this stuff. And yeah, that's, I guess that's kind of where I wanted to kind of conclude things. Darcy also made an image of the robe being danced by a river. But that's, yeah. I don't know if we want to wait till this is over. Or if we want to, maybe it's, we could start asking questions if there's time, or, the 3D printing yet.
So we've done, we had a timeline where they needed, like that piece, the scrub blanket piece that was shown that's going to be replicated, needed to be back here for, my sister had a scolahiplikwila for her daughter who's 10 months old. So I really wanted that piece to be used there. My grandma's 80 years old now, and she wore it. I wonder if these are in there. Those images, I think that ended too soon because those images are in there. This is my grandmother wearing that piece. And my sister Ava's dancing it, and my grandma's in the foreground with her best friend since childhood. So now that the digital, like the animated version is in Regina at the Mackenzie Art Gallery, for the next show that they open, I can't remember where it is right now, but the 3D printed version is in January, so we're just getting to start working on that now. And I think I've read some really interesting things about 3D printing textiles, which is fascinating. But there's so many different materials that can be used, and I'm not really opposed to them being synthetic materials and machine made, just because of the freedom it allows to take back certain pieces to be used in culture and the conversation it opens up. And also that it's being displayed on a wall in a museum. So for me, there's like no real reason that it needs to be able to flow and move. So if it's a static piece for a display, then that's okay.
She asked about the appropriateness of using non-Native people using Indigenous motifs in their art.
I think that there needs to be part of some of the problem of it, I think, is like the lack of education around some of the things. And kind of the entrance of things that were once sacred and have tremendous meaning and connection from a culture that's been drastically changed, I think, in a lot of ways through contact. So I think that there's like a possibility there, but I think there's also a danger there in contributing to a lack of understanding. And sometimes with like cultural appropriation and stuff like that, like in the fashion world, I mean, it's conversations to have, but in that instance, it's almost like you can tell when it's just like, oh, that's cool, let's take that, you know. Even in the snowboard world, it's happened. It was trendy for a while. But there's also, I mean, like, jewelry is sold very, very commonly, and that doesn't seem to make anybody uncomfortable or be a problem. I don't know. Big questions.
I'm just wondering if you could speak a little bit more about your thoughts on the division of male and female work, or in terms of tradition or the contemporary world, and if that's something you think about.
It was a question about gender. Gender roles.
One of the last traditionally trained weavers on the coast was Jenny Clonot, and Clarissa Rizal was one of her students, her apprentices, and through Clarissa's like small publication she did that was only 50 copies, and some of the people who descend from her, and even my teacher, it's said that women were usually the weavers of chilcat blankets and raven's tail robes. I don't know about basketry, but so that's been traditionally the role. And my teacher, William White, said that he received what he felt was his permission through a vision. He isn't sure what that vision is, but he has said that he won't teach other men, and that, that he feels it's his role to give back the weaving and strengthen the weaving art form for, he's had four female apprentices. And I think there's a cross-section of people of where they stand in terms of what they believe about it, but my own perspective is, I think there's room. Oh, and there's also
course, I said that too spirited. They sound like very taboo, like old school rules in a way, but there's varying degrees of like openness and closeness or like how strictly people follow it. But my kind of feeling about it, even though there's room for it, is that when I look at like a pattern board, traditionally there would be a pattern board that a male artist would provide on a piece of wood. And only half of it with no color, and then the female artist would use her weaving skills and translate that into the rope, which is very much like bringing intangible stories and mythology into a physical shared space. And we talk about a rope being born off the loom. So in some ways, I think that like the weaving of Chilkat ropes in particular is maybe like a mirroring of the creative life force. Like life energy, and that most life forms on Earth require male and female component. And I don't think anybody feels offended that only a woman can make a baby. I think it's the same energy sometimes. Sometimes I think it's that same energy, because when you get to a place with the weaving where you've gone through the technical aspects and then the alignment aspects, and thinking like that the robe and your weaving is a reflection of you, then there's a certain space where it feels as though the weaving has its own life energy too, similar to like how a plant grows and expresses itself in the physical world, and that a rope can't make itself in the same way that a tree can or a plant can, but it's the same intelligence. I think that's all a part of the work.
We're going to play the short video that Meghann just mentioned, and I'm going to take this opportunity to say thank you for such an inspiring presentation.